Starfleet Underground. Every week, we'll take a look at the latest Star Trek news and then check out a current or classic episode of Star Trek. This week, it's Cowboys and Starship Captains. Whatever happened to the holographic comm system? Can you fix it with duct tape? Catch some good vibrations from over 100,000 years ago? What's it like to be a Klingon in Star Trek VI? And I swear, there's absolutely totally nothing wrong with the transporter whatsoever.
Good day, everyone, and welcome back to Starfleet Underground. We have with us today a special guest by the name of Darnell. He is going to tell us a little bit about himself as well as some of his background. I'm sure you guys are just as excited to have him on as we are. Darnell, good morning.
Good morning, sir. How are you?
I'm doing great. Tell us a little bit about yourself.
I'm a local actor here in LA. I've been doing that for many, many years, and I've been very lucky. I was most recently in the fifth passenger, which was with tons of Star Trek actors. I was in Star Trek Renegades, directed by Tim Russ, and most lucky, I guess, the playground I had when I first got here, I was Klingon in Star Trek VI, which was just so much fun. So I've been here a little while, and I'm a lifelong Trekkie. I go to the Star Trek convention every chance I get, the local ones, and of course Vegas. So yeah, I'm a Trekkie born and raised.
I hope you realize that when you said all of your background in Star Trek, all the Tribbles in my cabin here just lost their minds.
I thought I heard something. Yeah,
they went nuts. So we're going to have to talk to you a little bit about your experiences before we dive into the show, if you don't mind.
Oh, no problem.
Okay, we'll do that. Next, we have Heather.
Hi, I'm Heather. I'm the science officer. And Darnell, I just have to say, I'm so sorry about that transporter malfunction. We had technical difficulties. I swear to God, we'll find your right arm. We will get to that.
Well, I don't use it that often, so we're good.
Okay.
And we have Rocky. Oh, I don't understand why the transporter messed up. Rocky, good morning.
I swear to God, they moved the button on the interface. That button was supposed to open the feed and send the right arm button, you know? I'm so sorry about that. It won't happen again.
You promise. Really. There are parts of my body that I do need. Parts of my body I'll be willing to get back later.
Piece of tape over that button. We don't mess with that one button. That one stays. A left arm, right. But the that's right it. Arm button, people mess with that sometimes, and I, you know, so sorry about that.
That's okay.
You could have had the operation remove his left arm, and then he would have been all right. So
I tell you what, I knew when Tilly spilled that drink on the console, it was not going to turn out right.
Well, she had red hair, didn't care. So.
And stuff is slipping and sliding all over the place.
That's for sure.
Oh, wait a minute now. Hey,
I wasn't talking about that button.
No, we're going to get to that a little bit later.
What kind of podcast did I join? What's going on here?
Did you not listen to our past podcast?
I guess he found the one clean episode. That's what happened.
The
one clean episode. That's what happened.
Exactly. I'll have to tell my mama not to listen. What's going on?
We're going to segue into that to try to calm down. We don't want to scare off our guests here running around with his left arm. So first, anybody hear any news this week?
Okay, I'll go first with news. Everyone's so excited about Star Trek Voyager. Of course, the 25th anniversary is coming up. I mean, the show's been around for that long. That's longer than some people. But the cast is reuniting virtually this Tuesday. And this course, when you listen to the podcast and do time travel and figure out which Tuesday I'm actually talking about, The 26th is the one that I'm talking about. So if it's after the 26th, just hit the little skip button because I screwed up. Okay. Other than that, if you can listen before the 26th, then yeah, it's 8 p.m. Eastern time, and it's on the starsinthehouse.com website and their YouTube channel. Ooh. And they're going to have Kate Mulgrew, Jerry Ryan, Roxanne Dawson, Robert Beltran, Robert Duncan McNeil, Robert Picardo, a lot of Roberts, and Ethan Phillips, and Garrett Wong as well.
Squeak.
Yeah, so that's like the whole freaking cast. They're going to be there, and they're celebrating, and they're going to be streaming, and fans can interact, and should be a whole lot of fun.
Oh my God, we totally have to go.
That is great. That's great.
That would be very awesome. I'm definitely looking forward to something like that, especially with everything going on Earth right now. We can't even really get a part of the conventions or anything. And for the social distancing. So
now, I don't know if you have to wear a costume to watch this on the stream. I think that's optional. I think
everyone's going to wear a costume anyway.
You could cosplay at home. It's all right. You know what? Cosplay and tweet everybody your picture, and that should be fun for everybody.
There you go.
Yeah.
I got some news too. Short Trek's Blu-ray and DVD will be coming out on June 2nd.
Ooh.
Yes. So what is that?
That's the whole thing, right?
Yeah.
All the Short Treks?
So 1 hour max, I think.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it'd be, you know, short and sweet, right?
Short and sweet.
That's a lot of cool content because all those Short Treks are so cool.
Yeah, they are pretty cool.
The Short Treks are really, really good, especially the one we watched this week. I enjoyed it. So
yeah, that was cool.
I can't wait to talk about that one because I'm becoming enamored of Anson Mount. I decided to watch all of the show that everyone kept telling me he was in, but I never bothered to watch it, and that was Hell on Wheels.
Oh yeah,
I just finished the last episode 2 days ago of all 5 seasons, and I gotta tell you, I can see why the women went nuts, because he's got the body I used to have when I was in active duty. So, and as well as he has a certain presence on the screen that just draws you in and makes you realize that this is a capable person.
I love the whole cowboy thing where it's a man of few words, because you're hanging on every word, because anytime he says something, it's just so damn cool. Because he has that screen presence. So it's that classic, you know, man who says almost nothing. And then when he talks, it means everything. It's so cool.
And he does it without Clint Eastwood's glare.
Right. He does. And Clint Eastwood's he's always been that grumpy cowboy. But you don't get that. I mean, Colm Bohannon was a little grumpy. He had reasons to be grumpy, but he had a kindness about him, too.
I thought Clint Eastwood just needed glasses.
That's why he was so squinting. Oh, yes.
That's why he was squinting.
Yeah, he just needed glasses.
Go ahead, clean my glasses.
That's hilarious.
Oh, wait, you're over there, not over here.
Did I fire 6 shots, sir? Where are you at? Come back over here. Yeah, stand right there.
I know what you're thinking. Am I nearsighted or farsighted? No, there. In my opinion, there's some actors who, by absence of motion, can all of a sudden become dangerous. And there's not many actors, in my opinion, that could do that. And Hell on Wheels, he was one. You have some people when all of a sudden they stop moving and they look at you. I know we just joke about Clint Eastwood, but he's one of them. And it's just, you just tell that, uh-oh.
Yeah. Just one little look and you're like, oh boy. Hold on.
So I haven't seen the show. Was he the super tough guy? Was he the Clint Eastwood character, or what was going on?
He was basically your strong silent type, you know? Mm-hmm. But the other thing about this show is so cool, because all the Star Trek people will recognize Chief O'Brien's in it.
Yep. He was in it.
He's a little grumpier than he usually is.
Grumpy is not the word.
He kind of plays the bad guy. Yeah. I loved the show so much, and that was a pleasure to watch. And then if you're a Stargate fan, the guy that plays the Swede he's been in Stargate and all these other sci-fi, all those shows that came out of Canada. I can't remember his name off the top of my head.
Yeah.
But he's a big, tall dude. He's so good.
He's another one. If anybody who's seen any of the vampire shows, he was in that.
Oh, yeah.
He's been in a lot of different ones. And he's another actor who I love to hate.
Oh, and he's got good screen presence, too. He's another one of those guys. Yeah, he's so good. Hell on Wheels was such a great show. Some sad parts in it, though. But, I mean, we're talking about, you know, the old days of the cowboys and making the trains, you know, the big train railroad back in the day, and you know, all of that violence, but it's so good. So good. Yeah.
Common was in it as well. Common was in it for a long time.
Oh, God, yeah. I loved his character. And he was another guy, great screen presence. Screen presence was there with Common. Yeah.
Wow.
And the Swede actor was Christopher Heyerdahl.
There you go. Yeah, Christopher.
And every time you see his character, if he plays a good guy, he's a really nice guy when he does a hero. But he's also one of those people like Gary Altman or what's his name from Third Rock? John Lithgow.
John Lithgow, yes.
When he does evil, you hate him. Oh my God, you hate
when
him.
When they're bad, they are so bad. Oh my
That's
God.
That's a good actor right there.
Oh yeah.
That is good. Yeah,
so much fun to watch those guys. Just,
like, what's her name in Lost in Space, who played Dr. Smith.
Oh.
I hate her.
Yes,
I
loving that too.
I just kept praying for someone to kill her the whole time I saw on the screen. It's like, someone make this woman die. Please.
I like that show. I'm looking forward to it coming back. It's a good show as well. Any sci-fi I really like, but yeah they did a good
season,
job.
It's going to be the last season, unfortunately.
Oh, I still haven't, don't spoil anything. I'm still halfway through the second season. I'm the don't spoil it guy, but that's kind of it with Lost in Space. I'm loving that so much, though. It's such a good, fun
show. It's
really
good.
Yeah, it's fun.
I feel the same way, too, about David Tennant. You know, he's one of those actors where he plays both sides really fantastic.
Oh, I know.
There's a British show. It's an interrogation show. I can't think of the name of it, but the police just interrogate somebody for an entire hour, and he is so good as the bad guy in that show. He is so good. And then Jessica Jones. He was amazing. Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Jessica
Oh,
Jones.
My God. Yeah. He needed to be that.
And then, of course, you know, we love him as the doctor. Have you seen Broadchurch?
No. Is that another one I should invest time in?
Broadchurch is a show that anybody that loves the doctor should watch, because he's the star.
Oh, okay.
And then you have I can't think of her name. The doctor that is the doctor now. I can't think of her name right now.
Okay.
She's in the show.
Okay. What was it called?
Broadchurch. The person that played the number one doctor for one episode, the guy that's in, I wish I knew these people's name. The guy that's in he's in Harry Potter as the guy that cleans up, and he's also in Game of Thrones as the one that Arya kills. He played in one episode of The Doctor, he played the first doctor. So in that show you had not the war doctor, the number one doctor.
Got it.
Yeah.
Oh, I know then, who he is. Okay. Yep.
Yeah. And of course, British shows use the same actors over and over again. So you have companions in the show, you have Torchwood people in the show.
Oh, cool.
So just as a Doctor Who fan, you are gonna see all these people in the show. You go, oh, that's that and that. But the show is so good, you forget about it after the first episode. You're just into the show. It's one of my favorite. I'm actually rewatching it as we speak, because it is that good. You'll really enjoy it if you get a chance.
Cool.
Okay, so we could use this to segue into, since we're talking about phenomenal actors, I've been lucky enough to see your work on several of those projects you mentioned. But let's jump in with being a Klingon, because that means you shared the the air with William Shatner, Mr. James T. Kirk, and Leonard McCoy. I mean, he was there too. Oh, so tell us about your experience. He's the one actor which I regret not ever having to meet. So let me just listen to your story in awe and jealousy here. So,
well, this was when I was young, and this was many years ago when I first got to Hollywood, and I was in the movie. I did an audition for the movie. They just needed big guys to be Klingons, and I was lucky to get the makeup on. Some of those, if you ever watch the movie, some of the people are just having masks, and then some people get the makeup every day. I got the makeup every morning. I had to get up and be there at Paramount like at 4 o'clock in the morning, which was no problem. You sit in the chair, hour and a half, 2 hours, you get your makeup on, and then you know, as anyone knows that has ever been on a movie set, you sit around and wait after that. But it's such a huge cast that they had a lot of makeup artists, and just so many people had to get so many things done. One of the gentlemen, he got his makeup on at 4 o'clock in the morning. He wasn't a Klingon, he was some other alien, could not eat for the entire day because of the makeup that they put on. But I loved it. It was beautiful. At the time, I was taking classes with a teacher of mine who used to direct T.J. Hooker. And he said, go up to William Shatner and tell him that you know me. So, of course, you know, any opportunity, I went up to him. I was in makeup and said, oh, this was 30 years ago. I can't remember the teacher's name. And he was like, oh, tell him I said hi. Here, take a picture with me. So he, yes, his kid, his grandkids were there. And he comes over and says, take a picture of us. Because, you know, this is before cell phones. So no one had no one had cameras. And it was pretty tough security. They didn't want, you know, people doing stuff and, you know, leaking any information. So he took a picture of me and him. And I think either his grandkids, one of his grandkids. But I searched for this picture everywhere and I've never seen it, hoping one day it'll pop up. So that was my experience with him. He was just the nicest guy in the world. Everybody was nice. I was on the show a month and a half maybe, and again, people would just start talking to you. One time I'm walking past craft service, Mark Leonard says to me, oh, hello, young man. I was a Klingon once, and starts just talking to me. He just starts having a conversation with me. And one of my favorite experiences, we went out to Simi Valley to shoot for the Kinnamer conference. And so we were staying out in a hotel out there. So every morning we would get up early. And about the time I would get up makeup, Brock Peters was, coming onto the set. And we just became friendly. And he started telling me all these wonderful stories about his acting experience, his life, you know, and seeing a young black man trying to break into the business. He was just filled with information and love and, you know, giving anything he could, just as being friendly and kind and being supportive. He was really, really wonderful. So for me, that experience will be hard to beat. Even if I star in a show one day, which probably won't happen, but even if I did, that one experience as a youngster will be something that will be very hard for me to surpass, because it set my tone for what I thought Hollywood was going to be. Hollywood was not like that for the rest of my shows, but for that one show, it was wonderful. So, yeah.
Cool.
Dude, you just made all the tribbles in my quarters just a lane here catatonic.
Yeah. It was great. Everybody was so kind and everybody. And I was just playing. For the courtroom scene, I sat next to Michael Dorn the whole time. And I was asking him about, you know, his voice training and, you know, how, I got to talk to him, because you're sitting there for 12 hours, you know, you're just like, you're talking to people, you know? So yeah, everybody was just an experience where you got, and it's one of my favorite movies too, because when we get to the end of the movie, when you watch the movie, when you see the signatures, you know, this is the last one that you're going to have with Kirk and Spock and McCoy, and it brings a tear. And no matter how many times I watch it, and even though I was a part of that, it brings a tear every time I watch it, because that was so much a huge part of all of our lives. It really was. And it's something, I won't forget. I had one scene where they had me floating around the spaceship, and I get to turn on the gravity. And so that's what I call my claim to fame. So
that's so cool.
Yeah.
That's so awesome, man. And you're right. The signatures come up on the end credits and you're just like, wow. I mean, because you're already in wow, because I just saw a really cool Star Trek movie, but you're just like, oh, wow, look at that. They signed the credits. That's great. Great stuff. Awesome.
If you've ever seen the Avengers Endgame, they did the same thing, and they said they took it directly from the Star Trek movie because it was such a powerful experience. They said, oh, that's beautiful. We have to do the same thing because we won't have this group of people in this movie ever again. So that's why they did it.
That explains a little bit more behind the scenes stuff.
And it's so cool to hear the behind the scenes was such a pleasant experience, and it's just a good time, people having a great time and good fun and chatting everyone up. That sounds great.
Yeah, it was.
So I didn't see that. They put their signatures at the end of the movie, like people sign their names.
Yep.
Yes.
Isn't that, not safe because then people could take that signature and, you know, forge it, because well, then they know what that signature looks like.
This was 30 years ago, so nobody even had that idea, probably. And plus, it's worth it. Just the experience of watching it, no matter what happens after that, it's absolutely worth it.
And Heather, I'd like to see you cash a check that you signed William Shatner and see what happens.
It could happen. We just have to get the right teller.
Rocky,
yeah,
you gotta do me a favor. Could you turn on the cloak? I just saw some rich person's yacht full of screaming women that are looking for Darnell. So I think our podcast is reaching out.
Cloak activated, sir.
I'm seeing they all got their hands to the winch to the portal, and they're looking out to see if they can see him. So cloak it, we don't want to.
I see that. And there's some Tribbles in there too.
Looks like you got a big fan base. We have to be careful here.
They don't recognize me because I only have one arm. So that's the problem.
Well, they just need to see your good side. So turn so they only see your good side, right, with your good arm.
All right. Stand to the left. Stand to the left near the portal.
Make your mark.
Thank you so much for that backstory. That gave me all kinds of the warmth. Fuzzies. So that was pretty cool. And I think this would be a really good segue into the short we watched. Did everyone see it?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Yep. Yes, sir.
And remind us, what was the name of the short?
Ask Not.
Woohoo! I think that did such a great job, how the way they had set it up, because they were testing a recruit. And when you're in the service, or you're anywhere else, or even if you're in a boss, and if you're supposed to have absolute obedience to your command, chain of command, I mean, that was tested. They wanted to see if she could be, you know, coerced into doing something different with somebody as well known as Captain Pike. Can you imagine you being on a ship with like Captain Kirk, and he tells you to do something, and someone tells you not to let him?
Oh my God. How hard would that be? Yeah. I would hate to be in that situation.
That's like almost a Kobayashi Maru right there, because it's like, well, how can you not just go follow the captain? But what if it's not the captain? You know, he's been beamed so many ways. Maybe he's the evil version of him. You just don't know. So you've really got to keep with your protocols that you've been trained with.
Mm-hmm. Well, I was going to ask you, Nathan, this is when I saw this, I thought of you, because, you know, you being a military veteran, is there anything like that in today's service? Would they put anybody through this? Because honestly, I thought this was cruel. It's a great episode, but I thought it was just extraordinarily cruel.
So. I completely agree. That was just awful and horrible what they did. And it was a dick move. Like he even said, this is inhumane. So you're admitting this is a dick thing to do.
One hell of a test. Yeah. That's for sure. Like,
yep, I would not have passed.
I don't know. I might not have either.
I would have had to lock him in the room and leave the room. I could not have stayed in the room with him. I could not.
We're going to kill your husband. Your husband's going to die.
Yeah, no way.
Well, the very first thing I'm thinking here is, well, she's got the phaser. Just stun his ass. He'll shut up real quick.
Yeah. And so here's the question. Was the phaser real? I wouldn't have taken that chance, because I might have shot him. I would have been like, I can't take it.
I would have shot him too, especially right there at the end. I'm like, ah, shut up. Phaser, you're done. Yeah. You're not testing me anymore. Let's stun you for a few hours, see how you feel when you wake up.
So Nathan, is there anything?
Yeah, no, there is in the service wing in boot camp to go over that. And I'll bring up the old joke. In boot camp, they tell you right off the bat when you're going through everything what the chain of command is. They tell you who's senior, who's next, and who's next. One of the things they like to do is that they'll have one sergeant tell you to do something and the other sergeant tell you to do something totally opposite, to sit and watch people actually run around in little circles and then cry. Because they don't know who to pay attention to.
So basically that explains my whole dealing career. I would have one floor supervisor tell us to deal one way and another floor supervisor to tell us to deal the other way. So I think they went to the same training camp.
Mm. Yeah, you have to listen to, they tried it on me, but fortunately I was a little bit older going through boot camp. So when I had one drill instructor yell at me to tell me to do something, the other one told me to do opposite, I did the one that was senior. The junior one started screaming and yelling that, oh, you just just ignore me. You just ignore me. And I stopped. I looked at him and said, sir, Sergeant Fightmaster is more senior than Sergeant Harrison. So therefore, this recruit will listen to the orders given to him by Sergeant Fightmaster, sir. Your orders are not valid. And they both looked at each other. They both held their head down so I couldn't see their face. And then they looked back up again. They went, go away.
Get out of here. You know what's going on.
So, what a way. Wow. But yeah, they do that. One of the things I was going to segue a little bit into, there was a open audition for CIA operative on the planet, on the world, of course. And they had three couples come in. Mm-hmm. Where the husbands were auditioning. So they left the wife alone in the room and they go to the first husband and goes, take this gun and shoot your wife. We need to find out if you're absolutely loyal to us. So the guy holds the gun. He looks at it and he goes, no, I just can't do that. And he leaves. They go to the second guy. They hand him a gun and they said, you got to go in there and shoot your wife. And the guy goes, I'm sorry, I just can't do it. So they go to the third guy, they hand him a gun, says, you got to go in there and shoot your wife. Guy takes the gun, goes in the room, and you hear bang, 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 bang. And then you hear all this thud. So they run into the room, and the guy's in there with the chair. And he's like, what are you doing? He says, the gun had blanks in it. So you don't know whether or not if something like it, if the phaser had blanks in it, or I mean, if it was set not to work. So that was kind of like the mystery question. Was that phaser really loaded? So
did you see what's the English movie about the spies and the young guy? That's every English movie. The Kingsman.
Kingsman, yes.
Yeah.
More recently, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. They did the exact same thing. And which probably is a little bit more realistic because you can see a spy organization asking you to shoot your dog. And because it's cruel, but it's not the same. It's not as high as shooting, you know, a person. And they had to go through that spoiler alert. They had to go through that same test. Again, I probably would have failed. I've all these tests I would have failed. There's no way I would have passed any of this stuff. I am not meant to be a spy. So,
well, Nathan, when you were telling that story, I thought what you were going to say at the end was they walked in and his wife was on the ground dead. And he's like, man, I've been meaning to kill that bitch for years.
That guy was seriously? You did me a favor, man. Right on.
I was thinking the same thing.
This thing, how many bullets are in this gun here? Yeah. Let me see. You want me to take out the whole clip? Sure.
That's hilarious, but absolutely true.
The way this lockdown's been going, I'm sure.
That's love right there, man. That's love.
There's a lot of people in that position like now waiting. Just like,
yeah, like Nathan, like what you were saying completely.
Shit, with this lockdown. In essence, I thought it was a really good short because, again, you saw Anson Mount's acting ability and mm-hmm. He just has something about him that you want to listen to him.
I was about ready to go take over and go take on the Tholians, man. I was ready to go.
Yeah, seriously. Which means she wouldn't have been stationed on the Enterprise.
Right.
So if she's stationed on the Enterprise, does that mean we're going to see her in the new episode that's going to be starting with Pike and all them?
It's a good possibility because I saw a lot of the shorts always have something projected onto when it comes. So I'm sure that actress that played that part is probably all excited because they'll probably have her in engineering somewhere.
Sweet. I hope so. I hope so. That would be good.
Speaking of engineering, did you see the size of that engine room?
I know.
That warp drive. Oh, my God. That was quite the little teaser.
Mm-hmm.
You see that shot of the Enterprise.
At least it doesn't look like a beer distillery.
Right. Yeah.
You know, okay. So let's use that as a segue into the main show that we saw, which is the episode 4 of Discovery of the second season. One of the things that I kind of liked, if you saw in the beginning, when Number 1 was walking with Pike, and he was explaining how the holo things didn't work.
That damn holographic communication system.
Yeah. And he's like, tear them out. I prefer the view screens anyway.
Yeah, that was awesome. Yeah.
Which I thought was pretty cool to tell you why on the ship they had no hellos. Everyone kept saying, why do you don't have
hellos? That was some serious fan service right there. because everybody's like, holograms on Star Trek, what the hell is this? This isn't the holodeck. They don't use this to communicate. And of course, some of us are like, they actually tested this in Deep Space Nine. They didn't have it by this time in Star Trek. This is completely not canon whatsoever. What the hell is going on here? And so they satisfied all those Star Trek nerds, and at the same time just conveniently fixed the effects budget, because doing holographic effects work must be amazingly taxing on their effects budget. So I just like the damn holographic comm system is like, we just get rid of it.
Just get rid of it.
Nobody's using it anymore. We're done with it.
Yeah, that was really awesome the way they did that.
Rip him out. And you know the pad he was working on was almost the exact same pad they used on Star Trek.
Oh, cool.
Did you see that little thing?
Yeah, that looked really cool.
It was.
Yeah, she brought it aboard and handed it to him. So yeah, that thing looked dead on. It's like, I wanted a closer look at it because it definitely felt like that pad.
I thought that was a really good fan service that they did, like you said, to the original series and to neatly tie in a bow.
And it's so funny and tongue-in-cheek at the same time. It's like, oh yeah, okay, we're done with the holograms. Get the fuck with the holograms. They're gone. They're just, screw all you guys. No more holograms for you.
Seriously.
I like the view screen anyway.
Yeah, I feel like I'm looking at freaking ghosts everywhere. Yeah. Just the screen.
I would have loved to see the conversation in the writer's room when they said, you know what? Just get rid of them. They're done.
That was really good. And then right after that part, like immediately after that part, when number one and him sit down to talk about Spock and how she's going to like try to save Spock, I'm thinking they totally fucked in the turbo lift. Like, they totally did.
Oh, down, girl.
I watched
that
episode.
It was the title of our episode last season. I'm just saying what everyone already knows. Oh.
You got a whole other side to number one that I really would like to actually see on screen. Did you see the size of the cheeseburger she ordered, by the way? Not to be picking on that, but that looked like a really yummy cheeseburger.
Yeah.
Although she put hot sauce on it. I'm not a hot sauce guy.
No.
I am, so it would have been love.
Yeah, I mean, it would look pretty cool.
I watched that episode you're speaking of, Heather, and I watched it yesterday because the one we watched made me want to watch that one. And I did see that kind of, they may hook up, and maybe that's why she left the show. She couldn't take it, or he couldn't take it, or whatever. So I'm interested to see where that relationship goes.
Yep.
But we do get to see some of the other characters come in, from what I understand. These are just rumors, but they're talking about possibly McCoy, possibly Uhura, possibly we might see the nurse come in. So,
I would love that.
Yeah, so and that might just possibly slowly come in. As time goes on. But I am looking forward to that relationship because they did have a connection that was really good.
It was, and even when you talk about the actress that played Major Barrett, she had a thing for Spock also.
Yes.
So that carried over. Yep. Where number one, I could see because she was more Vulcanish. And Spock wasn't so quite in the beginning.
Well, yeah, and it really made me think of that relationship with Nurse Chapel because they were played by the same actress. They bring it in. This time, they're both basically Vulcans. She is more Vulcan than he is because in that episode, they both say, fascinating, at the same time, and they look at each other and they go, oh, true love. So.
and you notice the eyebrow. She did the eyebrow, the Spock eyebrow.
Yeah. Yeah, so yeah, that's a good connection. I'll be looking forward to that.
Bow chicka wow wow.
I tell you, that turbo lift is a rockin'. It gets stuck more often on that ship than the holographic communication system gets stuck.
Is that why they're always going in the turbo lift together?
And this is what this pond is for.
Yeah.
We also get a chance to see Saru is finally going through his metamorphosis. Now, we're re-reviewing the show, so if you haven't seen Discovery, the second season, this show is going to be full of spoilers. Mm. But you do see Saru is finally beginning to change into his badass.
I thought he caught the cold, too. Is it, we're watching that scene, and we're like, Linus has six navel canals, and like, so he catches colds all the time. Mm-hmm. Obviously, Saru caught it, so Saru looked miserable. I'm like, oh my God, get that guy some NyQuil or something.
Well, he looked like he was out partying all night and he had a migraine or a hangover. Oh, it's like, dude, don't party.
And then salt and tea? What?
Yeah. The rhinovirus, the cousin of the coronavirus.
Absolutely.
Oh. Yeah. And when they told him, you know, hey, maybe you should be going to your quarters, it's basically like, okay, so that's translation for quarantine, motherfucker. Mm-hmm. You're getting everyone sick.
Stay home.
Seriously, don't even bother coming.
The name of the episode is Opal for Quran, or however you pronounce it. And I looked it up. It was Coin for the Dead. And it really made sense, especially with the entity at the end passing on the information and Saru not having to be afraid of death anymore. He became a whole new person. So it had a lot of good things as far as that was concerned, relating just to the title. Although I like to call it the duct tape episode because
Jeff Reno on screen is so cool.
I love seeing her just fight it out with Stamets. They're like brother and sister, like they didn't from another mother. They're just like, they get together and they're like, friction. Oh, great. Yeah.
I really wish they kept her a lot longer than they did. Now, they were talking about that planet and they were saying the planet was vibrating. And I'm like, oh, cool. It's a masturbation planet for women.
Oh, my God. And Reno would look at you and go, we can fix that with duct tape.
Exactly.
Yeah, Heather, you need some duct tape.
But that interplay between her and Stamets is just, oh my God. Yeah. They really, and her deadpan delivery.
She would not back down, and she just kept coming at him, just like, oh my God.
She is great.
Yeah.
When I saw Apollo 13 years ago, I said, watching it, they had to do that math calculation. I said, oh, I could never be an astronaut. And then they fixed everything with duct tape. I said, oh, I can do that.
It works so many. It solves so many problems.
Exactly.
I mean, as a production guy in TV and film and doing all that kind of stuff, you actually lean a little bit more to the gaffer's tape because the gaff tape is like the ultimate solution. Duct tape actually leaves residue everywhere. Yep. So you don't usually want to use duct tape. So that's a pro tip for everybody.
If you're
using something to attach your car, if it's going to go around the track on NASCAR and you just want to make sure the camera sticks on it, just use some duct tape. It'll be fine.
You ever watch a show called Naked and Afraid? You have an item you're supposed to bring from you to help you survive the 21 days you got to be out there in the middle of nowhere. And one of the guys had brought a big roll of duct tape. His partner made fun of him until she saw all the stuff that he made. He made a hammock out of it, shoes, make her a little bikini.
He made a hammock?
The one episode of Mythbusters that's probably one of my, and I love Mythbusters. I mean, that's a great show. But the one where they started building stuff out of duct tape, the entire episode was so educational to what the uses of duct tape are for. So cool.
Seriously. It's like it's the Wonder Seal.
If you're going to space, you should pack a roll of duct tape.
Thank you.
Well, if you go anywhere, you should pack a roll of duct tape.
True.
Absolutely. From now on, that's it. I'm packing it no matter where I'm going. You know?
Yeah. That and Flex Seal, and you can make a boat.
And it was cool to see something normal like that, like be brought into Star Trek, just like with the universal translators malfunctioning. Technical difficulties.
Oh my
you don't
God.
See technical difficulties often. I love it when they put technical difficulties
when the universal translator goes out and just starts translating you into whatever random language it feels like doing.
Yep.
Boy, does that cause complications.
That is an important part of the show, though, because if you know, one of the complaints that Star Trek fans have, they watch a Klingon speaking in Klingon, but his lips are moving in English. And in this, everybody's lips were moving in whatever language they were speaking. So if you're speaking French, your lips would, and that was very important for them to do that instead of just having a voice come come over. It showed that it looks like your lips are speaking in whatever language you're speaking.
That's the dedication.
That was a detail that was so important. Mm-hmm. I really liked about this episode, because that just fixes so many complaints that you hear about the show. And in 1 5-minute scene, there it is.
Mm-hmm. You notice, like in every job, when something goes to hell, who do they call? The alpha geek. They call Saru. Yes. 94 different languages.
Yeah, it comes in handy.
Yeah, get the alpha geek in here.
Saru, we need you.
But I'm sick. I don't care.
And that's actually a perfect segue into what I was going to say, because Saru comes in and he's sick and he starts touching every single person's freaking panel. That bugged me. It's like you're going to this panel, then you're going to that panel, and you're wiping your nose and you're just touching.
The only scene that made me feel happy about everything currently is when they threw Tilly into the quarantine. It's like, you damn it, you quarantine her. She's got an alien on her. Oh my God. Oh, seriously. Saru's rocking around sneezing on everybody. He's just like, oh man, touching everything. He's fixing everybody's panels. Like, you guys gotta go wipe that with alcohol after, right?
That's hilarious.
It's like being on a cruise ship, because they can't go anywhere. They can't, you know, do anything. They all have to be in that one area with these people.
Yeah, everyone should be wearing a bubble. Just wear a bubble, you'll be fine.
And then you had Tilly with the wild woman hair. That was like, oh my God.
That was great.
That was great. So funny. Tilly in this episode was just awesome.
There's like, boof. It was all out there.
Does your hair have enough volume? Well, we've got a solution for you.
You know, so I thought that was pretty cool. And what was not cool, I thought, was a little wild. And at least they sterilized it. Was they going to drill in her head?
Oh, dude.
Oh, that was so creepy.
What is that?
That was so creepy.
Oh, God.
Talk about medieval times. Oh, my God.
It was so. Yeah. Like, oh, my God. You're going to. Oh, but then they started singing Ground Control to Major Tom. I'm just like,
that was cool.
It was the only song that would calm you while you're doing the most horrible friggin' thing on the planet, drilling a hole in the girl's head.
A freaking lobotomy.
Like, yikes.
She's getting a lobotomy.
Like, whoa. What happened if she sneezed?
Oh, kids at home. Kids at home, put the drills down. This is a bad thing. Don't ever do that. God. Wow. Yeah. There's so many things. What if you, like, one little like slip of the drill? I'm like, whoops.
Seriously.
Like, oh, God.
Can you imagine a drill to your temple just going in even the slightest?
Then you'd be like, oops.
Exactly.
Oh, my God. What do you mean?
It just, oh, man.
Oh, my God. Just.
So what song would be your guy's song that you would sing? I was thinking about this. I was like, they told you to pick a favorite song. I couldn't pick a favorite song, but I don't know. You know what song I could get through to be that calm. I was thinking it had to be a Prince song, probably, maybe Purple Rain or something like that for me. I don't know.
I think I would do Savage Garden, the Chicka Cherry Cola song, because I need to concentrate. You know, anytime I need to see your face, I just close my eyes. I could do the whole song. I don't want to, but I will.
Oh, please do.
Really? Because I could.
Yeah, absolutely.
I totally could. Oh God, I'm a horrible singer, by the way.
That's okay.
Anytime I need to see your face, I just close my eyes. And no, I can't do it now. There's pressure. And a Chicka Cherry Cola.
Speaking of songs, it reminds me of the episode that we were talking about before when they're stuck in the elevator, and she does that entire song.
Oh, I know. That was pretty cool.
How did she memorize that? I've been trying to memorize that for years. For 20 years, I've been trying to memorize that. I get to the first line, I go, what am I doing? It's an impossible task. So, yeah.
The song that I would have picked that would make Reno uncomfortable while she's getting drilled in my head, I would stare in her eyes and I would do When Doves Cry. Engaged in a kiss. And then again, she probably would have continued drilling.
Yeah, the drill. She's
like, oh yeah? Oh yeah, buddy?
Need to drill a little deeper here.
Oh, jeez.
She'll look like, I could fix that. You took tape.
Oh, duct tape. The song that Tilly picked, it was a new song. I like that. Like, they finally did a song. They did a song on Star Trek that was a new song that was talking about starships. I'm like, finally.
I know.
Yeah, that's true, actually.
Yeah, it wasn't an older song. It was a newly minted to make it sound like it was something that happened.
Yeah, it wasn't like they were going to recite something from Beethoven or whatever. It was, it's kind of, it's the current trend is to sneak songs that everybody knows now into Star Trek and make it effortless. Like, when you watch Next Generation, then music comes up and it's some symphony or something classical. Yes. It's not current from our time. So it's like, yeah, so they'll just slip a little Bowie in here, you know.
Since the JJ movies, they've done that. And then I've noticed that even in the short treks, they've actually had references to people and music that we can relate to. Like you're saying, not just Beethoven and Mozart. We actually can have Audrey Hepburn and have music in there that we can relate to.
Yeah, they'll bring up the Beatles or something like that. Yeah.
Exactly.
Bare Naked Ladies. Just saying. So when Tilly was in there, and after all this, she gets sucked into that spore thing. And when they open it up and all these spores come out, did that remind anyone else of the video game The Last of Us? Did you guys play The Last of Us?
I'm not a video person.
I heard it was really good, but I don't have a PlayStation.
I didn't realize it. I thought that was a show. It's not a show.
It's a video game.
It's a really good one. I heard it's okay. Really good.
It's so good. I've beat it twice. Maybe three times. It's really good.
Wow.
Yeah. And then she climbs out after all that. How do these people not display more symptoms of PTSD after shit like this?
It's just
they did mushrooms.
Yeah, they're doing mushrooms. That's what it is.
They have to be doing something to calm down because Jesus, the stress of all this.
Because that's what the spores are. The spores are mushrooms. So
it's all about. Yeah. So hold on. We're not going to destroy you. We just want to give our information to you. So we're going to, you know, try to be polite about dying in front of you and not exploding to a million pieces. So, yeah, it's the mycelial network. Same sort of thing. It's like, well, no. We just want to, you know, we just want you to stop destroying our world. So here, have a little stuff, something, get a little high, maybe come to your senses.
Yeah, feel good, don't feel scared.
Yeah, it's a great defense mechanism.
I agree with you. I would be so freaked out every time I put on my red shirt and went out for a mission. I would be freaked out.
Yes.
You know, there's no way. Every time I came back.
So. That's why I always do laundry. I do laundry every other day and I never miss it. So that way I'll never run out of shirts and I won't have to wear a red shirt.
That explains it. I wondered why you're in there every night, every other day like that. Now I know why.
I had a friend who forgot to do her laundry and it didn't work out. Let's just say.
Oh, can't wear the red shirt. Nope. That's what it's not there for. Hmm. Now, the one thing which I kind of like that you brought up there, Darnell, is to show how a good commander, or in this case, a good captain, is he wanted to do what he wanted to do to the orb that was there. And everyone went, no, don't do it. And rather than being kind of like an asshole about it, says, no, I decided this is what we're going to do. Screw your suggestions. Mm-hmm. We don't have the time. He took the time to listen. He's like, okay, what's your suggestion? And that's what a good commander is. One of the things that I learned, I had a master sergeant explain this to me one time when I first was newly promoted. And he, because I was concerned about taking over a unit, one stuff I wasn't 100% certain how to do. And he pulled me to side and he told me, and it's like, look, you don't have to know everything. You just got to know how to manage the people that do.
That's good advice.
And that really hit me between the eyes. And that's what this guy does. That's what Pike does. He listens to suggestions. And he turned around and goes, okay, that's actually a better idea than what I had. Let's go ahead and go with that.
Well, in the episode that we were just talking about in the elevator, Spock asked, number one, what are Captain Pike's attributes? And that's exactly what she says. She says he will listen to you. And if you have a better idea, he will use your idea. So, yeah.
And that shows that there's no lack. He has no ego, basically. Because some people that are so egotistical, it's like, how dare you try to come up? I've had bosses like that. And,
we all have. Yes.
I hate those bosses.
They just don't want to listen. And he does what I thought, again, a good commanding officer does. He hoped for the best, but he planned for the worst.
Yes.
Yes.
It's like, get ready, eject the core, get ready to do this, get ready to do that. All right, lower the shields. Let's see what's going to happen here.
Yeah.
you know, really good job. And to Heather's profound enjoyment, we saw Saru topless.
I was thinking about that. I was like, oh, he's topless. Check out Saru. Why doesn't he walk around without a shirt more often?
He was looking pretty good.
For a dying alien, he looked pretty good. Yeah.
Well, I mean, he looked like he worked out and everything, you know. Just saying.
Doug Jones is the nicest human being on the planet. Have you guys met him? He is just night, and that's not an exaggeration. If you swatch, if you see any pictures, this is a concern for me for his pictures now, because his pictures aren't just pictures standing next to each other. He grabs your face and kisses you and holds you and hugs you, every single person that takes a picture with him. So unfortunately, that's probably going to have to go out the window for a little while, but that's not him faking it or pretending. No. That is him. He is such a genuinely nice, caring person, and he is talented. Have you guys seen him on What We Do in the Shadows?
Oh yeah.
He is great. Everything he's in, he's great. He's very talented and extremely nice.
We should look to see if we can get him on the ship. When you get a chance, Heather, see if you can locate him and we can see if we can do a trench beam.
Yes, sir.
We could, like,
see if he's interested in doing a promotional calendar shirtless.
Oh, my. Of course, you're going to ask me to do that.
Just, you know, like the firemen do. Yeah. The firemen do that kind of thing. You raise money for charity.
Absolutely.
I think Saru would be down for that sort of thing.
The calendar title will be, What Would You Do with Saru?
Can we bring Patrick back, please, to help?
Oh, he would love it. Oh, my God. He would definitely love it. This was definitely a show. It just showed why, I guess, so many people like the second season of Discovery more. Because you get the crew is gelling. They feel like a crew now, you know. And you get a chance to see a little bit of the unknown, and you see Pike being command and also weighing, kind of like what Picard does, weigh what his superiors tell him and go with his gut instinct on what's really right.
Yeah, you've got a captain that is acting like your typical starship captain you'd want to see on Star Trek. It's so good. And then the crew is coming together, and an episode like this, the family bonds, there's this, the whole part of this episode was, I mean, some of it was about, you know, what happens when you go away, but the other half of it was you need family to support you. And even if it's you're at each other's throat, like the engineers are just, you know, I want to do it this way. No, I'm going to duct tape your ass. Or if you're just like, no, Michael Burnham, you're like my sister now. I mean, that those family bonds are there in the crew. And it's just one of the beautiful things about the show that I like.
Well, I mean, he said he replaced his sister with Michael Burnham. And I'm thinking, how rude.
That's probably a translation issue, right?
Oh,
that's
right. There you go. It's the universal translator.
Here, this was her knife. Oh, yeah.
In the first season, he's like, I don't trust you. I don't really like you. And to the point now in second season, it's like, hey, sis. So, yeah, that their relationship has grown.
Yeah.
That's a
yeah.
huge change. He hated her. He hated her. You know, she basically got the captain killed. So that's a huge change to become someone's sister. So, yeah. Yeah.
It was done well. I liked the growth. They really did a good job on having everyone grow, including with Saru when his little danglies fell off.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And he's like, I'm not scared anymore.
Yeah. Now, one of the things that bugged me about the show was actually them saying that the planet that was vibrating, the vibrating planet, sorry, but they said it, they said it was 100,000 years old. And they're like, oh, it's 100,000 years old. It's ancient. We need to get all of its vast knowledge from all of this time and blah, blah, blah. Dude, that pissed me off. I'm sorry. Okay, 100,000 years old is not old for a planet. It's super young. Like, just to give you guys an example, if you look at the Orion's belt, Betelgeuse is around 8.5 million years old, and Earth is supposed to be 4.5 billion years old. So for them to say, oh, it's 100,000 years old, it's ancient, I'm like, are you freaking kidding me?
It wasn't a planet, though. It was a probe.
Yeah, I didn't think it was a planet either.
It was a probe.
It didn't feel like like a planet to me. I mean, they said it was a sphere, but I thought it was more of an entity or something.
It wasn't
necessarily a planet.
No, it was a probe.
Yeah.
It was kind of a thing.
But you're right. 100,000 years old is not that old in the span of things. Yeah.
No.
I think they weren't referring to the how old it was. It was the amount of information that they were able to gather from it was that amount. And for 100,000 years, that's a huge amount of information.
It's not the planet sitting there and it's bored. There's nothing around.
No, but they're saying the thing is, if you remember, it traveled.
Oh, is that what they said?
It had scans of everywhere it went. Yeah.
Oh, okay. I missed that part.
Because remember in the following episode, remember when they said they lost Spock's signal?
Yeah.
Well, you find in the fifth episode is that it passed by Spock's shuttle and it had scanned him when it was on its way there.
Oh, I missed that. Okay.
Yeah, so it's not a planet. It was actually kind of like a big V'ger, but in red.
So what, it's like a giant probe that was probing the universe?
Oh, you said universe. Thank God.
Bow chicka wow wow.
Oh, I was waiting for you to say probe something else.
I like the way when it expired, it went off with a beautiful bang.
Yeah. I have to tell my mama not to watch this or listen to this.
Sorry.
That's okay.
So what was the point of the probe if it's going to collect all this information and then blow itself up?
It was dying. And that's the whole thing that Saru said it helped trigger him, because it didn't want to die without passing on what it knew, what it found out, the breadth of its information.
If it was creative, if someone created it, wouldn't they have had a way to, say, transmit this information wirelessly so that way they get the information?
Well, they did, but the only body that was nearby was the Discovery. I mean, that's the only thing that came through. It was ready to pass information off. It was like, come on, I got to tell somebody before I go away. Here's, I got the secret to the universe. And there's no one nearby. And then they get the ship here. And it was like, here's the secret to the universe, except I can't speak your language. And let me try to tell you. And then, of course, what happens is the ship's communication systems go crazy.
In that case, I give that engineer a failing grade.
Yeah, it wasn't but, quite, you know, that engineer doesn't quite speak human engineer. I mean, it can't just have it all work perfectly.
And I didn't even get the impression that it was made. I didn't know if they had even come up with how it was created. I just thought it was, I just considered it just there. And I didn't go into the origin story, but it could have been made, but it could have been just, you know, an entity that was out there doing what it was doing.
Yeah.
So it's alive.
And it spoke. It had a language, because they didn't discover what the language was until
vibrate.
Yeah, no,
it's
also
personal with that.
No, it was also
ultraviolet vibrations. Yes, yeah,
yeah. It was the light. They actually had a chance to see that it was basically is how we use a lot of our, before we went to plasma conduits, we were using fiber. So a lot of our stuff is still on fiber, and you multiplex light because light can be broken down to all kinds of bands and carry information. So it was trying to talk to them that way. And that's where Saru was able to pick it up, because he's got, as we talked about before, his eyes can pick up a lot more nuances than human eyes or even the sensors, it seems.
I kind of liked how in this episode, you start off and you're getting all this techno babble getting thrown at you. Mm-hmm. And it was pretty heavy. And throughout the episode, you start to understand what was actually going on. And it's like, hey, I understand the techno babble. I know what's going on. This is what's happening. This thing is talking and trying to get its last dying breath out. It's information that it has accumulated and just trying to share information with somebody. I love that. I think it was very cool.
I'm not a techno babble fan at all. I am a Firefly kind of guy where you're not sure the captain even knows how to fly the ship. So I
love Firefly.
I like that about Pike, though, because Pike is like that too. He's like, well, I didn't quite pass Astro, whatever it was, but
exactly.
But I'm listening to what you guys think and we'll go with whatever you guys think.
Exactly. I did think they figured out things a little bit too quickly, like when they were in engineering. Okay, we'll run this over there for the gas line and that'll work, and we'll drill a hole in her head, and I was like, dude, how are you figuring this out in split second?
Yeah, the solutions came fast and furious. That's true.
I was like, wow, how, you know, again, I couldn't make it in Starfleet because there's no way I'd be, you know, I'd still have my abacus out trying to figure this stuff out.
That's why they don't let me run the transporter all the time, because I sometimes hit the wrong button, you know.
Someone goes missing an arm.
We can get it back. We can get it back.
You know you're never going to live that down, right? I'm never letting you forget this. Just saying.
Just make sure his arms match the same length again. Don't have one arm super long.
It may tickle a little bit if you raise it a little too high, but don't worry. That's perfectly normal.
Give him the T-Rex arms.
No, not the T-Rex. I need to work out today. So I need to lift some weights.
Oh, it's arm day. Okay.
And make sure that it does it correctly. We don't want him to raise his right arm and then his left leg goes up. So that would not be a good idea.
It'd be like young Frankenstein. He puts his arm out, you just can't get it back down again.
No, we don't want that part.
Putting on the Ritz.
Yeah.
Seriously. Oh my God, we have you on as a guest again. I don't want to say it. So this is Darnell.
Zuba-duba! Oh, that's great.
So please make sure when he goes, you fix him correctly.
It's only the arm. Everything else is right.
All right.
Now, the end of the show, this is the first of the season that they actually ended on a minor cliffhanger because Tilly gets sucked. Mm-hmm. And we don't know what happens to her being sucked until the following episode.
Heather's not giggling, right? Okay.
I'm thinking it, though. I'm doing good. I'm not saying anything, just but I'm totally thinking it. Okay.
You know, so, and you brought up post-traumatic stress disorder.
Mm-hmm.
Again, spoilers. This is where he's going to find, what's the doctor's name? His boyfriend, Stamets' boyfriend. I see his face.
I just call him Doctor.
I got Wilson.
Wilson?
That's the actor's name.
Yeah.
I can't think of him. I only see the pictures of him with his shirt off.
Right.
Man is unbelievably cut. I mean, unbelievably cut.
You know, Saru and that would be a great win for the calendar. Call him up too.
We got
to
make that.
If you haven't seen this, Heather, you have to look at this guy. It's unbelievable. I'm so jealous.
In that case, if we're doing the calendar, we got to get some chicks in there too.
Yeah, he's okay. Dr. You.
I know. Nobody was excited for that. Okay, yeah. Well, yeah, women, okay.
No. So he definitely is. So you get a chance to see him, not with his shirt off, but you'll get a chance to see him on the next episode dealing with post-traumatic stress disorder and what's that happened being caught in the mycelial network the whole time.
Yeah. That's for the rest of the season he's dealing with that. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah.
And so that actually, it's good to see them address real life issues.
Yeah.
You know, so like they did with holodeck addiction, because you know that would be totally a thing.
Mm-hmm.
So they did with the Next Generation.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't they do holodeck addiction with Deep Space Nine too?
Oh yeah, way they did. Yeah. They
with
did
Nog with
Paper Moon. Yeah,
yeah.
With Nog,
mm-hmm.
He didn't want to leave.
That's a great episode,
because sometimes fantasy world is better. It's
a different kind of addiction. Yeah,
right. Because escapism.
Yeah.
Well, that's what they do. I mean, when you do drugs, when you do any kind of like addiction, it's usually escapism. You're mm-hmm. escaping from something.
And he had just lost his leg as well. Exactly. So he's also dealing with the post-traumatic syndrome. So, yeah, definitely.
So he's trying to escape from that reality.
Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, what happens, and I think part of that has to do with what's going on current day on Earth, is with this COVID-19. Most people naturally believe that they're invulnerable to whatever happens. That's why you have some people who overly speed in motorcycles, because they feel that this can always happen to someone else and not them.
Yeah,
and so when you finally have something happens to you, that shifts your whole paradigm. You realize you're not invincible. Luck is a whore. She'll sleep with anybody, and there's no turn that you see she's going to leave. And when once that happens, it's a shock.
Yeah.
And that's where it comes in at. Some people can deal with it and some people can't. So it's going to be interesting on the next episode, which is going to be called Saints of Imperfection. For those of you listening, that's your homework next week, is to watch Saints of Imperfection, because that's what we're going to be talking about. And the short, since we love our girl in red hair, we're going to go ahead and watch The Runaway. Yeah. And that's going to actually be a little bit of a foretelling on when they get a hold of this woman again to help them with their engineering issue. So next week's going to be The Runaway and season 2, episode 5. 5, Saints of Imperfection. This was an outstanding episode. And Darnell, if we promise not to have any of your body parts missing, would you ever come back as a guest again, please?
Well, we'll see. You know, at the end of the day, give me a call. If my fingers are working and my toes are wiggling, I'd be happy to.
But we can send the shuttlecraft. I mean, we do that too for some people.
Yeah,
they tend to like the shuttlecraft a little better.
Oh, wait. I just got a personal message from Heather. She volunteered to personally inspect you physically to make sure that everything is in its proper place.
Well, I was thinking if we're going to do like some fun stuff with the teleporter, can we enlarge certain parts of the body? I'm just curious.
Oh my God. All the male crew members will be walking around with a wheelbarrow.
So yeah, basically, don't tell your mom that you were on this podcast.
Oh, yeah, never. Can't.
Sorry, mom.
Can't let her know.
Oh man,
guys, I had a great time. Thank you so much for this. This was wonderful. You guys are so funny, and I love talking about all nerdy things, especially Trek. So I had a great time. Thank you.
We'll probably bring you back again because, like I said, we're being trailed now with a yacht full of women. So
we'll and Tribbles. There was a Tribbles, too.
Tribbles as well. So thank you so much. And if you want to, let me just stop because my mind is going all kinds of different ways thinking about the wheelbarrow. Thank you, everyone, for joining us on this episode of Starfleet Underground. Make sure you stay safe out there. Wear a mask. Wash your hands for at least 20 seconds. You can either do the opening of Star Trek to yourself for twice, and that's 20 seconds, or sing happy birthday to me, sing that her birthday song twice, and that equals 20 seconds. Use soap and water. Be careful out there. And all of you, please, just don't have a great week. Make it so.
Starfleet Underground, beaming in to a podcast feed near you. Log on to our website at starfleetunderground.com and send your comments and questions to thecollective@starfleetunderground.com. Follow us on Twitter @StarfleetUnderG and on Facebook and Instagram, we're Starfleet Underground.